lunch, so it's a nap time, so I'll do my best to keep you focused here. I was just visiting over at the Organic Trade Association, which is actually on the fourth floor of the Marlboro building that we were at, and I saw yet another, I don't know if you've all seen it yet today. I was driving this morning from Concord, New Hampshire, so I missed the latest bit of circular firing squad nonsense within our organic world, but there's now something out called organic spies, which is yet another attack on big versus little organic, and you know the usual kind of stuff that we're having to deal with these days. And it's ironic to have just seen it only minutes ago, because it's in fact something that I wanted to talk with us all about. But I'll come back around to that. I seeing it though reminds me of my favorite philosopher, Lily Tomlin, who says, "No matter how cynical I get, it's hard to keep up." I think you'll get the gist of what I'm talking about here in a couple of minutes. I really appreciate what's going on with this conference, and I frankly really, though I do recognize that you all are taking great pains to make sure that we all understand this is regional, and certainly since we can throw a frisbee to New Hampshire from here, it's helpful for me to know that. But I also very much appreciate the Vermont roots here, and the 10-year legacy of the Strolling of Heifers, and all that you've been doing. I think this opportunity to pause at least once per year, now with this conference, to take stock of where we stand in the effort to bring sanity to our food system is not only welcome, but it's really absolutely essential. I've been working on the issues that we're here talking about for actually 3.5 decades. You can see it in the gray. And while we've made decent progress in growing the organic movement, really, from a handful of true believers, some of whom are in this room, by the way, to the status of a bona fide $30 billion industry providing about 4% of America's food and fiber. The truth is that when you look at what this movement is all about, when you look at the decline of the disappearance, not just decline, of a million family farmers since I was a boy, since 1960, we don't have another 30 years to get this ship corrected. We actually don't have the time that we've had to evolve to this point. And so there's an enormous pressure and urgency, I think, to share these lessons today and to engage in these kinds of dialogues as never before. And before I get into some of these challenges and opportunities, what I want to do is I want to put this movement that we're here to celebrate in what I think is the proper perspective. I want to share a few adventures that we've had along the way in these couple of decades, not so much because I want to look back, but because I think what we're really talking about here is about inventing the future. And as the old adage goes, if you don't learn from the past, then you're just doomed to repeat it. And many of us who are grasping and really making traction now with this whole notion of organic, of local, of sustainable, we don't have the time to relearn the lessons that a lot of us gray hairs have been through. So I want to try to share some of these with you. Again, I've been doing this stuff since really 1976, which is, I calculated last night, 60% of my life. And along with a lot of other wonderful people in this room and a lot of many nonprofits and activist groups that we've all been a part of, Stonyfield and I and all of us have tried to develop not only ecological, not only notions of new ways of looking at agriculture, but really new ways of thinking about economics that embrace and support principles of ecology. And, you know, like the folks who inspired this conference right here, thank you, you know, I think that we're at a very poignant moment. I think we not only need to expedite our evolution quite rapidly, given the scale of the challenges, but I also think that we need very definitely to address this issue of our own MO, our own modus operandi within the kind of progressive movement. The word circular firing squad, as I used it, is really something that I've resigned myself to. But I find that it's just very odd that we progressives spend as much time infighting about sort of making the perfect the enemy of the good as we do doing our very important and good and important work. And obviously I represent nowadays big organic, I suppose, although I don't even know if I know what that means. So I want to talk to you about that. But what I really want to do is remind us what the context is of this work. And just to set the stage, let me just be a little bit personal for a moment. I grew up right next door in New Hampshire, in the outskirts of Manchester, which is the largest city in the state. It was once, in my day, southern New Hampshire was a bountiful agricultural region, actually, certainly a bountiful agricultural state. And I watched it suburbanize during the course of my childhood and my own life. We bought our eggs, our chickens, our turkeys, within blocks of where I live, not what are now blocks. And our lamb on holidays was from folks down the road who knew all the lambs, the animals' names. The milk was supplied by farms that were within 10 miles of our house that was delivered in glass bottles at the doorstep. I know, you know, I'm not that old, right? This is not that long ago. And my children, I have three college-age kids now. They've grown up 18 miles from there. They've grown up in Concord, New Hampshire, from where I spent my childhood. And while they know that they're avid organic gardening parents, my 18-year-old daughter calls us the organic freaks. So those of you who have adolescents know something about what I'm talking about. It's not their fault. It's just an illness. They'll get around. They do come back. I've watched the oldest start taking away from me. Have faith if you're there. But nevertheless, as they've complained over the many harsh hours of labor, of, you know, composting and double digging and weeding and planting and harvesting vegetables, to be honest, they would not recognize anything I just described to you about my own childhood. It is as foreign to them as going to another country. And that's, of course, what we're here to try to reverse. It's a way of life, the way I grew up and the way many of you grew up, it's a way of life that really disappeared within one generation. And again, all you have to do is look at the statistic of the 1 million family farmers who were here and who are not here. So I hardly need to lecture this audience about the transformation, but the fact is that the disappearance of our local farms and our farmers and the demise of the rural communities that we've all known and grown up with has really been accompanied by equally disturbing and parallel trends, which I began studying back then when I was studying ecology and climate change and dendroclimatology and other esoteria of the day back then, although very much in the norm of mainstream science today. And I learned back then in the early 70s what we all know today, and that is that we have really evolved down a flawed path as a species, as a society, not just in terms of our relationship to nature, which of course we have absolutely abused and screwed up, frankly, but also on really fundamental, we built our economies on really fundamentally flawed assumptions. In fact, I would even go further and say outright myths that go to the heart of how we govern ourselves and how we think about economics. We've had these basic myths, like the myth that waste is an acceptable byproduct of our economic activities. There's no such thing as waste in nature. Everybody here knows that. The waste of one system is always the food for another. The myth of a place called Away, where we send our waste. Some of you have heard me tell the story that when I was building, we exceeded the capacity of our local wastewater system in Stonyfield. We had to build a waste treatment plant. The traditional approach to waste treatment, which is still very much in the norm today, from generations of wastewater engineers who learned that the solution to pollution is dilution. We take our biological waste, add it to water, oxygenate it, agitate it, add some chemicals, and then we're left in an aerobic system, we're left with sludge, lots of it. And in my case, it was going to be a truckload of sludge every single week that we would have produced if we had built one of these really antiquated but conventional systems. So I asked our local authorities, well, what do I do with the truckload of sludge every week? And they told me it's very simple. You send it to Vermont. This is a true story. That was literally their answer. And of course, I was sitting there thinking about Ben and Jerry's, you know, sending it back to New Hampshire. And, you know, midnight sludge, you know, trading at the Connecticut River. And anyways, I didn't want to deal with that. We built, as the happy punchline is, we built an anaerobic facility. It's a biogas digester. It generates fuel that runs our facility. Frankly, it's been incredibly profitable for us. Dramatic reductions in water, energy, labor. No sludge, by the way, being produced at all. It's just quite extraordinary. But that wasn't my point. My point is that we had this idea of a way. It happened to be Vermont in that case. It's just completely mythologic. There is no such place, as we see with climate change. We have the myth that the Earth is infinitely resilient to handle whatever abuses we deal up. We actually think this. No one will say those words, but we actually behave this way. Or no one will particularly say these words. that we believe that the earth, we have the myth that the earth is a subsidiary of our economies, that it's there for the taking and it's there for the dumping. And actually, the exact reciprocal is what's true. In the history of humankind, all economies have been made possible by a bountiful earth. We are the subsidiary of the earth. But we behave literally in a very deep way, exactly the opposite, okay? And so I'm trying to say all this to underscore the scale of what we're taking on. And then we have the ultimate myth, the one that I think is the most pernicious of all. And it's the myth that we allow ourselves in our economic theory called externalities. It's this allowance that we give ourselves. You remember externalities. These are the direct economic consequences of our economic behaviors, such as climate change, such as a national obesity epidemic, such as a national diabetes epidemic, such as the fact that 41% of us, according to the latest the President's Cancer Panel, are going to be diagnosed with cancers. These are direct consequences of economic choices that we make as a species, but they don't appear on our income statements. They don't appear on our balance sheets. Therefore, in economics, they don't actually exist. And more importantly, more profoundly, no one's held accountable for these. And this is how deep we're talking about here, okay? We're not just talking about, you know, helping to stimulate local agriculture here. We're talking about rethinking the fundamentals of our economic system. And of course, these myths go on and on. They reveal themselves in ample ways that I don't mean to overly depress you, but my intent is to depress you a little bit for a point that I'll get to. And I think I'm doing a good job, right? For example, water now. In my lifetime, our lifetimes, water has been seen as a renewable resource. We now know it's a finite resource. It's being talked about as the oil of the 21st century in ag circles. Worldwide water usage has actually doubled every 21 years in the last 100 years. And it's mostly due to unsustainable irrigation and soil management practices. Topsoils, 50% of the topsoils that were here when Lewis and Clark made their way across the country are gone. They've disappeared. And the net result of putting more marginal land into production, or, you know, in the past, in history, of course, we just went to new places when we burned up our topsoils. By the way, we're not the first culture that's done that. The Greeks did it, the Romans did it, the Mesopotamian cultures did it. And these cultures expanded to other places after they burned up, after they depleted this resource that is not renewable unless we renew it. And the net result of that is that what we've done is we've stopped having horizontal areas to go. We've gone deep. We've gone down into the ground. We've pulled up natural gas, which we turn into fertilizers. You all know the story. And we've increased our global fertilizer use in my lifetime 100-fold, 100 times per acre in this country, because we have not engaged in the true process, the true ecological process of building systemic fertility or capacity, and relying instead on annual infusions of drugs into our soils. You know about hypoxias, there's 400 of them. We're killing off estuaries from Chesapeake Bay to the Gulf of Mexico with allowing nitrogen runoff. You know about biodiversity problems. We're now losing 50,000 species per year, one species every 20 minutes. But the most serious, even of all of this depressing stuff, you're now wondering, why did they invite this guy to come talk to us? The one that troubles me the very most of all of this is the toxification issue, which is profound. And really, we've been on a 70-year spree with chemicals. You know, people say to me, Gary, organic's a really nice idea, but it hasn't actually been proven. But actually, I would say it's the chemicals that have not been proven. And yet, the data is coming in. I just quoted the President's Cancer Panel. By the way, this panel, which was primarily staffed by Bush appointees, so don't think this is a partisan point of view, implicated the number one reason that 41% of us are going to be getting cancers is that we have is the day-to-day exposure to chemicals, primarily in our air, our water, our soil, but primarily in our food. We're exposed to somewhere between 80 and 100,000 human-made chemical compounds every single day, and nobody has looked at the synergistic impacts, because there's some 3 billion combinations. So only a fraction of those have ever, only a fraction of those have ever been tested for toxicity in adults, let alone children, and so forth. So it's against this background that the question was asked earlier of your ag secretary about GMOs. And I just want to really speak to this, because ultimately, this will come back around to this question of entrepreneurship and what we're doing here, as you'll hear in just a moment. You know, despite 30 years of incredible progress in the organic movement, we now face, I think, the greatest threat yet. And it's really the fruition of several decades of seeding and investing by the world's largest chemical companies to create a sense of urgency or even inevitability about GMOs. I mean, our policymakers, the majority of our policymakers in DC actually have drunk and in some cases bathed in the Kool-Aid, okay? That, you know, we must deregulate genetically modified crops to feed the world, to feed the 9.2 billion that are gonna be here. And we have to learn from what has happened, because in what can only be described as a truly brilliant, even diabolical, certainly elegantly orchestrated effort to fund research that yielded the desired results, to donate millions of dollars to campaign war chests, to purchase congressional and senatorial seats, not to mention a few presidential seats, which has the added benefit of winning a Supreme Court, which did probably the most profoundly destructive decision in the history of the Supreme Court with the Citizens United decision a year ago, which, as you, I trust you all know, allows corporations to give unlimited amounts. This is, corporations are people too. It allows corporations to give unlimited amounts to campaigns and not even report. And then they've invested, on top of this, in this diabolical campaign, tens of millions of dollars in lobbying efforts to help glue the whole sort of pernicious package together. And the net result is now that large numbers of decision makers across our nations really believe that these technologically advanced seeds are critical. Now, here's the only problem. 13 years after introducing genetically modified corn, soy, cotton, and other crops, but primarily those three, into our food system, not only have they failed to fulfill the promises of higher intrinsic yields, and this is hard data that I'm sharing with you, but farmers using these crops have actually increased herbicide use by now close to 400 million pounds in 13 years. That's a tenfold increase in herbicide use or reliance on systemic toxins. The alfalfa decision that was mentioned earlier today on this stage in January was solving a problem. This is the decision to deregulate genetically engineered alfalfa. This was solving a problem that didn't even exist. Only 7% of alfalfa out there was using herbicides. And so now the deregulation of herbicide-tolerant alfalfa, which we know will spread adventitiously and through pollen, is profoundly bad news, particularly here in the Northeast, where one of the things that we are really good at growing is grass. Alfalfa is hay, of course. I think everybody here knows this. And so now we're seeing, on top of the tenfold increase in reliance on these toxins, we're seeing actually the most dangerous trend of all, if I haven't scared you enough. And that is, and we're particularly seeing this in the South, an explosion of these so-called super weeds, these herbicide-tolerant weeds. As the farmers have put more and more herbicides on the crops that are now tolerant of the herbicides, the weeds have not stopped to do market research to figure out what to do, right? They've just evolved very quickly to becoming herbicide-tolerant themselves. And when you have herbicide-tolerant weeds, when the herbicides aren't working, then you put on, you know what, defoliants. And this is exactly what's happening. Literally 2,4-D is on, Vietnam era 2,4-D is on the increase in our country. So my real question, and by the way, just not to drive you absolutely batty today, but Monsanto's CEO, you know, but incidentally, you understand these chemical companies sell the herbicides, they sell defoliants, and they also own the seeds. And in fact, Monsanto's CEO recently announced that half their profit growth this year will come from GE seeds. This is a chemical company making half their money from the seeds. They whipped us and our policymakers into a frenzy that GE is the only hope for our future. Now the problem, folks, as we sit here today and look at inventing a different kind of future, is these genies don't go back in the bottles. Once they're out, they're out. Super weeds, herbicide tolerant super weeds, you can't say go away now, we don't like you anymore. 90%+ of corn and soy are genetically modified in this country. So what are we going to do about it? So my first question to you today is, are you depressed enough yet? Okay? And I'm serious in asking the question because it's really important, because I know I'm preaching to the choir here. I know who I'm talking to. But I really believe deeply that our challenges today are greater than they've ever been before. And that we need completely new, and I mean political solutions as well as economic solutions here. We need a completely new approach to dealing with these problems, which of course is the point of this conference. But we cannot be confused. This is not your hippie mom or dad's organic movement anymore.
Right.
Okay? And the folks who built their economic power in the 20th century in an era of innocence, ignorance, but also blindness and also denial about externalities are not your average status quo. Okay? Well, these economic interests have a serious interest in holding on to their control of the marketplace. And I'm out there in the marketplace. I see this every single day as they try to crush me like a little ant. And in many cases, they're pretty successful. They're very good at what they do. They are quick to use words like sustainable and green and natural, even though those words can mean absolutely nothing because there's no legislation behind them. They're not like organic, you know, which has regs with penalties and teeth. Natural means, you know, I always say there's ice creams out there that don't change shape when they melt. They still say natural on the label, okay? You be the judge. And although fat and sugars taste great, they're quick to say, okay, you know, thanks to Michelle Obama's heroic work, you know, they will move out of some of the, they will reduce fats and sugars, but they're just as quick to substitute in other synthesized solutions that are just as bad for you or possibly worse in the first place. And they're really good at marketing the images that they want Americans to buy into. Yoplait took a page, for example, one of my competitors, you may have heard of them, a little company. Yoplait took a page, and they admitted out of Stonyfield's book by using their yogurt list to promote once a year breast cancer awareness. And to give credit where it's due, they've raised millions of dollars to fight breast cancer. My wife is a breast cancer survivor. It's a subject near and dear to me. But if they really wanted to do something about breast cancer, they should just switch to organic. Mm-hmm. It's very straightforward. And somehow they haven't yet listened to me, but we're still working on this. Yeah. So, I mean, I have this really simple idea that if it's going to be in a package for consumption, it ought to be food. I know that's kind of radical. It actually ought to be made of real food. So I want you, there was a method to my madness here, and you'll forgive me for layering on a lot of what you already know, but I think we have to understand the scale and the scope here to be truly, truly focused on the work that we're here to empower ourselves to pursue. I want you to take stock of all these feelings of shock, dismay, outrage, anger, incredulity, that we, in the 21st century, could still be such an immature species and so underdeveloped and produce foods that make us sick in a manner that makes us sicker. I want us to really feel that outrage. And I want to take inventory of the fact that in the entire so-called national debate about health care last year, you never once heard the words preventative care.
Yeah.
Even though the cheapest and best health care is to not get sick in the first place. That's a lot of what we're here to focus on. We didn't debate health care. We debated sickness care,
yes,
which, you know, needed to be debated, but we need to get on with real health care. And I want you to take the full measure of the fact that these economic interests, these folks who made their money and established themselves in the 21st century, on 20th century, on so many false assumptions and mythologies, are allowed to do this because we consumers are allowing them to do this. This, in the end, is our greatest challenge and our greatest opportunity. And I want you to take all these feelings and ask yourselves, am I doing everything I possibly can with my whatever I'm doing today to reverse these trends? And that's the question I asked myself back in 1977. I went to New Alchemy Institute. Many of you will remember I learned that it was possible to produce completely nutritious foods without recourse to not only using toxic chemicals, but also without fossil fuels. We were growing food year-round. We had birds, bees, bananas, butterflies in a greenhouse on Cape Cod with no fossil fuels being burned, none at all. I learned that by mimicking nature's complexity and by using the waste from one system to become the food for another, that we could actually feed 10 families 3 meals per day, 365 days per year on a tenth of an acre. Tenth of an acre of New England. We had the science back then, and frankly, it's gotten a lot better now, and a lot of people in this room are responsible for the progress. But what we lacked back then was an economic model that could prove to doubters that we could fuel our economy with these strategies, that we could create jobs, that we could increase exports, that we could take ourselves to scale. In other words, we weren't showing the status quo industry, food industry, how they could profit from these strategies. And then when Ronald Reagan came in, and you'll remember the cuts, you know, day one, the cuts on of organic research, of renewable energy, of basically everything I was doing, that stimulated us to launch our little business. And Stonyfield was really launched out of the ashes of that. We began turning the milk from our 7 cows into yogurt for sale for the very reason that we needed to come up with an economic model. We needed to support our activities, and the grants had dried up. That's the true story of Stonyfield Farm. We borrowed $35,000 from a group of nuns, literally the Sisters of Mercy. We actually got a nun with the deal. We got a bookkeeper. She came along. Pretty good for two Jewish guys, I'll tell you. But, you know, I often look back at those days, and I have some friends here who were with us in those days, and I say, you know, I'm reminded, it was crazy. Starting the organic yogurt business in 1983, I mean, very few Americans were eating yogurt, and nobody knew what organic was. I often say we had a great business back then, we just had no supply and no demand. But, you know, I'm reminded of Churchill's famous quote that success is the ability to move from failure to failure with no loss of enthusiasm. And by that, we've been very successful and enthusiastic. But what I want you to understand, the entrepreneurs in the room, is that, you know, we went through 9 years of doing the impossible, 9 years until we made our first penny, 9 years to get to a whopping $10 million in annual sales. And believe me, we burnt through lots and lots and lots of money. We made tons of errors. But where are we today? Today, we're supporting 1,600 family farmers. Average herd size is 70 cows through the Organic Valley Cooperative. Their milk is out there. In 2010, we actually bought our 1 billionth pound of organic milk. I did my Vermont statistics on the way over here. We bought 50 million pounds of organic milk from Vermont in 2010. That's $14 million that we injected into the Vermont economy, and obviously a lot more into New England. Our milk purchases alone this year will support over 180,000 acres of chemical-free farmland. That's avoiding, just to put it in hard numbers, about 9 million pounds of synthetic nitrogen fertilizer, about 425,000 treatments of synthetic growth hormone or antibiotics that are avoided, avoiding over 185,000 pounds of insecticides or herbicides. So these are decent numbers. And as important as the volume of our purchases are the practices that we've developed, which can definitely be scaled so that large processors can absolutely source from, reward, and support sustainable family farmers, growers, and fishers. And I want to underscore this. The point of my remarks here is we need an economic model. And regardless of your feelings about scale, the reality is, you know, we need both. We need the very small, we need the very large, as I'll hope to make the case here in the last couple of minutes here. You know, just to give you a sense of some of these practices, I mean, the key that you need to understand is that my gross margin, and I think you all know what the gross margin is, the margin that's left after my, if I take my revenues, I deduct my cost of goods, what's left for me at the back of the yogurt works, before the yogurt goes out in the world, before I spend anything on advertising or sales or G&A, my gross margin is 10 points worse than Yoplait's or Danone's, okay? Mm-hmm. They're in the 40s, I'm in the 30s, okay? Just 1,000 basis points. And yet my net margins, my bottom line, are better than theirs. Something happened between gross margin and net margin that allows me to make it up, and it's pretty straightforward, and I'll come to it in just a second. But let me underscore why we are where we are. First of all, of course, we pay our farmers 60 to 100% more than they get for conventional milk. Now that's not such a great statement, because the problem with that is the denominator. Because conventional milk doesn't pay any family farmer in this country a wage worth a damn. Farmers cannot make money on conventional milk, particularly right now with corn prices going through the roof. So frankly, organics is the only solution that I see for dairy farmers, and I know there's plenty who will debate me on that. But believe me, their kids, the next generation doesn't debate. Kids are leaving those farms in droves because there's no economic future. By the way, the exact reciprocal is true with our organic dairies. 100% of our dairy farmers, 100%, are engaged in one or another process of passing on to the next generation. That is, farm kids. I have farms, I have organic farmers. I have one dairy farmer in Vermont who told me when he was conventional about 15 years ago, he was telling his kids to get out of dairying. And we eventually convinced him to switch to organic. He went through the transition. We funded him through the transition. Today, his 3 children each have an organic dairy farm. They've actually gone from 1 to 4 farms. By the way, he's still farming. He shouldn't be. He's in his 80s now. But you know, he's making money. Which, and he said to me, he said, I made more money In the first year, once we were fully transitioned to organic, then I made in my entire 40 years before this.
Wow.
And that's a sad fact. I mean, most of our dairies in this country, conventional, are living off of their depreciation. That's why you see the barns run down, the fences run down. They're just not doing the maintenance and repair. So we, as a company, we provide transitional loans to get them through the 3 years. We provide technical assistance for on-farm manure management. We talked about, that was talked about earlier today, veterinary assistance, biogas digesters. We fund local feed mills. We fund, even if it's not our customers, the Maine Organic Milk Group, the split-off group of 9 farmers in Maine. We, Stonyfield, provided the founding dollars to put them, to get them up and running. We couldn't buy their milk, they were too far away, and so forth, but we got them up and running. It's by the way, the dairy cows on these farms, they live, I don't know if you all know this, they live 100% longer. They live twice as long as conventional farms. So that's why the UVM study came out and showed these farmers, our organic farmers, are earning somewhere between, earning, bottom line, somewhere between 70 and 80% more than their conventional counterparts. We also buy about 30 million pounds of non-organic, non-dairy ingredients. And we buy nothing non-organic, so we buy 30 million pounds of non-dairy ingredients. We're involved in the sourcing of over 80% of the agricultural crops going into our ingredients. That's how crazy we are about this. We want to know where it's grown, who's growing it, how it's grown, how much they're paid, what are their practices, and what, how are they impacting the environment in their communities. And to wit, for the 140 commodities that we buy, because of course in the yogurt business you buy a lot more than milk, it's cocoa and sugar and fruits and so on, flavorings. We've actually created grower scorecards and toolkits to try to educate and motivate our ingredient growers about sustainability issues and practices, which actually help them to improve biodiversity, help them to decrease water use, help them reduce greenhouse gases, help them to improve labor, but ultimately help them to make more money. And I could give you lots and lots of examples of this, but with time limited here, I'll just tell you that we actually literally conduct life cycle analyses with most of these growers. So we're able to work with them on reducing footprints as well, and it's all for the purpose of getting them more profitable, because at the end of the day, we think our supply chain's economic health is critical to our economic health. And so there's lots and lots of examples from buying DHA instead of buying it by harvesting whole fish. Our DHA, our omega-3s, come from fish waste, which is just basically using the waste from a system for food. Our organic vanilla, by choosing to use only organic vanilla instead of something that is allowed under organic standards called guanops with other natural flavors. For the last 25 years, we were actually a pioneer in the development of the a market for organic certified vanilla all the way back to the 90s. And today we represent actually about 15% of the world's demand of organic vanilla from this one little company across the river here. Organic bananas, our banana source is a cooperative of small family farms in a really remote area of the Caribbean, right on the Nicaragua border in Costa Rica. By paying a premium price for their produce, we are actually participating in keeping over 100 families not only out of poverty, but actually they're making more money per hectare than any of the farms in the southeastern Talamanca region. And maybe the best example of all is our organic sugar. I was at a workshop, Vern's wonderful workshop earlier today, where there was a discussion about size and scale. And you know, the question is, can you still practice organic at scale? Let me tell you, we buy organic sugar now from a cooperative of 40,000 acres in Brazil. And it's an absolutely extraordinary agro-eco story. The traditional way of growing sugarcane, if you all know, or harvesting, is you go in and you burn the fields. And when you burn the fields, you do that to get access to the cane, because there's a lot of leafy matter. Obviously, there's a lot of photosynthesis going on to make sugarcane. So you're left with a huge amount of biomass, which in our limited human mentality, we see as waste. You know, get rid of the leafy matter, it's done its job. So we burn it, which is obviously a global warming, you know, contributor of the first order. And if you've ever flown over these fields during a harvest, and I have, it's just an enormous increase in CO2 in the atmosphere. And it's doubly stupid because you're actually burning up the nutrients that were built up in the topsoil during that season, which means you have to replace those nutrients next year with synthesized fertility, which has obviously a much greater footprint. So our farmers, our partners in Brazil, determined they didn't want to be part of this linear, extractive, polluting system. So they started green harvesting. What that means is they literally shred the material that is being, as they're harvesting the sugarcane. And here's the punchline. The topsoils underlying these fields are now equal in carbon content to the native forests that were there when the colonists went in there. You know, it takes 100 years to build an inch of topsoil through nature. They're building inches per decade. Those fields, I mentioned the statistic about Lewis and Clark and the 50% of our topsoils, those fields are never exposed to the erosive effects of wind or water, because as they're harvesting the sugarcane on the low PSI tires so they don't compact the soil, the duff matter is built up about a meter thick around there. So there's enormous amounts of biota. So they've had a 90% reduction in pest damage with no, since they were conventional. They've dramatically improved their topsoil content. They've increased their groundwater and improved their groundwater quality and volume. They've had 189 species, actually that number is dated, it's 312 species that have actually returned to these fields now in the latest biodiversity survey. So they're actually creating an entire food chain. There's cougars bigger than me that wander in these fields because the whole food chain is intact. But here's the punchline. They've had a 10% increase in yields over when they were not organic per hectare with lower inputs. So their yields are going up, their inputs are going down. And that means that today, right now, organic sugar costs exactly the same as conventional sugar. Because on the conventional side, input costs, we all know, at $100 a barrel, or it's probably 94 today, but you know, those input costs are going up, and the yields are not going up. They're either staying the same or dropping. Here's a little subtlety about this operation. They put so much carbon matter into the soil that when they have a drought, which they have about once every 3 years, the organic producers deliver everything to market because that matter retains the moisture, stops it from being evaporated into the atmosphere because there's carbon in the soil absorbing. The farmers nearby, most of them never deliver their crops their full harvest because they don't have the, they're losing all their water and it's too expensive to keep irrigating and replacing. So anyhow, the bottom line here is that we have a lot of examples of success at our scale. And certainly the greatest success, I want to bring this right back to what I said before, has been this gross margin model. Understand that, again, my net profitability, I'm supporting farmers at a proper price, they're making money, which has to be goal number one, right? The nurturers of our land. And yet, I'm still making more money than my competitors, even though my gross margins are poor. Now, how do I do that? It's very simple. I don't spend as much on advertising. By building, doing the right thing, by making something that's really delicious, and by making something that people believe in and feel good about. And of course, that's why we use our lids and our packaging and our social media, and that's why, to my daughter's horror, I wrote this rap song. You know, it's whatever it takes, right? And I'll just tell you quickly the story of why I know this is true, this economic model is true. Some of you have heard this story, so forgive me, but I love it, because it really taught me everything I needed to know about marketing. I was standing in Florida about 2 years ago. I was holding a competitor's cup at the shelf. It's actually 3 years ago. And I was reading an ingredient. I still frankly don't know what it was. It's a non-organic company. And a little old lady came up to me and tugged me on the elbow and said, "Young man, somebody your age really should be eating the Stonyfield instead." And I said, "Well, why? You know, why is that?" And she said, "Well, do you know that they give 10% of their profits to environmental causes? And they were the first dairy in America to pay farmers not to use synthetic growth hormone." And she started rattling off these statistics. I said, whoa, how do you know this stuff? She said, "Well, you know, to be honest, my husband died of colon cancer about 6 months ago. And I want to be around for my granddaughter's graduation, and I want to see the kids get older. I'm not ready to leave yet. And the girls and I," she was referring to her bridge club, we go to the websites of the companies whose products we buy." And, you know, here she was, you know, attacking an unsuspecting consumer, right, in the market, telling them, and of course I hired her on the spot, right? but, you know, she told me everything I needed to know, that if you do it right, if it's delicious and it's nutritious and you talk about what you do and you promote what you do, your practices, that's as good as advertising. It may be more effective than advertising, because ultimately loyalty, which stems from emotions, right, loyalty is an emotional reaction. That's really the holy grail. That's what we ultimately want. So to encompass what I just shared with you in a very simple paradigm or a very simple summary, I would just say simply that What I set out to prove with the seven cows back in 1983, and what everyone here is trying to prove every day, has been proven. One can't create commerce where everybody and everything wins. I know this sounds like really Pollyannish, and maybe, you know, he's got something else in this cup, but there in the history of agriculture, going back to the earliest civilizations, it's always been about taking. Taking soil, taking water, taking habitat, taking away farmers' rights, taking away the rights of those yet to come, the future generations, taking away consumers' rights to safe and healthy food. And what I now understand, what we've done, is we've created a model that doesn't have to be this, that doesn't have to be this way. You know, our farmers make more money, our shareholders make more money, our employees make more money, our employees even get sabbaticals, where if you've been working 5 years, you get 2 months of paid leave to go off and refresh and recharge yourself. Our livestock, I've already mentioned, they live twice as long. Our retailers, by the way, make more money because they penny profit on a hot, more expensive product. Our distributors make more money. The planet has made more money. These have all been accrued ecologic wins, not just economic wins. And so have our children, because we've actually been building topsoil, creating a basis for farmers' kids to take over the family farm or start their own. And so I want to be clear on this issue of scale, this circular firing squad, this thing that we fall into, big organic, small organic, you know, local versus not local. Honestly, we need to do it all. We need to do it all. I mean, my wife and I garden and farm. We are members of our local co-op. We belong to the first CSA in America in Temple, New Hampshire. We belong to multiple CSAs today. You know, obviously, you know, we walk the talk. And Stonyfield supports hundreds of these initiatives, hundreds of these per year. But there are compelling reasons to get to scale as well. And let me try to close by quickly summarizing five that motivate me. Number one, organic. There's 1,000 reasons to eat organic food. There's one reason not to, and it happens to be a very good reason. It's too expensive. Organic still remains, 24, 28, 30 years later, it still remains food for the elite. And the only way that we're going to get it affordable and get it access to the billions without screwing the farmer is scale. You know, I'm able to do that. I learned that in the early days when Peter and Bunny Flint started supplying us with milk from Chelsea, Vermont. And we had to send a truck up to Chelsea to pick up the milk every other day. And then we picked up 2 farms and 3 farms and 4 farms and 5 farms. But the farms were spread out all over the place. The costs per load, per gallon of milk, were ridiculous compared by the time it landed at my plant. Because don't forget, it's not just the price, isn't just what we pay the farmer, it's the price that has landed to me. And so, and Peter and Bunny needed other farmers to get to scale to buy grain and feed and to get veterinary assistance. There were no vets in Vermont at the time who could work with them on homeopathic techniques that were needed to be organically certified. So they had to get to scale. We had to get to scale. And again, you know, there's a lot of myths in this whole cheap food thing. I don't mean to say that we, you know, when I say we've got to make ourselves more affordable, I don't mean to tell you that I bought into the myth, the American sense of entitlement about cheap food, because it is a myth. You know, we pay a lower percentage of our incomes on food than any country on earth. That's a true fact, by the way. And a lot of it, by the way, is because it's subsidized. In fact, we're subsidizing through our tax dollars. And this gets me into the campaign finance route that I don't have time to give you today. But nevertheless, you know, we still can't hope that people are going to move as quickly as they need to towards organic if the premium remains up here where most folks can afford to be here. And so I'm attacked often by folks, friends, peers, for selling to Walmart, but that's exactly why we're in Walmart. Because there's a whole lot of our fellow colleagues out there, a whole lot of our neighbors and friends who can only afford to buy their foods. There, or at least that's, you know, that's where they're buying. And so we want to be there. If you believe in the principles of organic, you got to believe that organic food should be everywhere that food is sold. That's airports, you know, talk about food deserts, et cetera. I also want to say that, you know, just as an example of a technique to bring the cost of organic down within range while not screwing the farmers, understand, I keep this price up there. Our price is always between 60 and 100% more than conventional, no matter what. So, but for example, we were, thanks to Michelle Obama, there was a solicitation made to sell organic, to sell multi-pack yogurts into some Western school districts. And our little six-pack of Yo Kids is too expensive as a six-pack. So we put our brains to this and we figured out, because we couldn't compete with Danone and Yoplait as an organic product, we figured out that if we could turn our six-pack into a 48-pack, therefore using less cardboard, less packaging per cup, we actually got to the same exact parity price as Danone and Yoplait, and we're able to sell organic food into schools at the same price as those guys while the farmer still earns the proper income. That's what I'm talking about, okay? That's the kind of stuff. With you, I promise you, my wife refers to the first 9 years, and a lot of you are living it, so I say this with empathy. My wife refers to the first 9 years as the bad old days. You know, in those days of hand to mouth, of not knowing, you know, of the, you know, the milk pump going down, and the power going out, and not having enough money to do repairs, and the, you know, if, I mean, you all know these stories, you're experiencing. You know, I couldn't have done some of this stuff at that scale, and I'm deeply empathetic, I understand. Second argument for getting to scale. We need to fund and expedite the transition from conventional to organic. And the only way we do that, don't forget, these farmers go out on a limb for 3 years, in many cases, or 1 year with their livestock. They have to pay the higher costs and get a slight decrease in yields for the first couple of years before the yields rebound. But they're not being paid the proper price for organic. So we have to fund that transition. John Hamilton is here. We have a fund through the New Hampshire Community Loan Fund where we do exactly that. Organic Valley does the same thing. For us, finding economic ways to deliver the foods, to show them the markets and then help them through transition requires scale. Third, we really need to eliminate the broken subsidy system in which we're underwriting truly regressive practices in this country. That too takes political power and scale. You know, John Tester, the senator from Montana, has actually gone on record saying the farm bill is broken. You know, as we go into it, it's a grab bag. It's a game of large corporate interests going in there to get what's in there for them. And the possibility that we're going to get really progressive change as fast as the planet and we need it through the farm bill are very difficult. That doesn't mean we shouldn't be playing in it. But to level the political and economic playing field out there, we need economic power. So we need to get to scale, whatever that means. Of course, we need campaign finance reform, as I mentioned. That, too, means we've got to reach large numbers. Fourth, and this is the one that I'm spending 95% of my time on. We need GMO labeling. We need to have a national label law. This is a right to know issue. In Europe, I don't know if you're all aware, GMOs are actually legal in Europe. People say they're not legal in the EU. They are legal, but there's a labeling requirement. And so 82% of Americans, by the latest poll, say they don't want to buy GMOs, but they don't know. Most consumers say they don't want to buy GMOs, and yet 90 to 92% of the soy and corn and cotton that is out there has now been contaminated with these seeds. So we need a labeling law. And by the way, I think Vermont needs a labeling law, and we could talk about that some. But the point is, again, the marshalling, believe me, the forces that I'm talking about challenging, the power, the clout. You know, we've got the science, and we've got the people. And we've got the, you know, we have the data that shows that the promise of GMOs are not being delivered. But what we need is we need the organized political effort, and that is another argument for scale. And finally, we need to prove the cradle-to-cradle notion. We need to prove the idea that we can have an economy, going back to my new alchemy days, where there is no waste, where the waste of one system is the food for another. Our new packaging that was just mentioned can feed the earth. It can literally go back into the earth. And our Greener Cow program, where we're actually helping farmers to get off of corn and get onto flax, high omega fatty acid grains, which allows the animals to live longer, be healthier, improves the omega-3s for us, reduces methane output. By the way, burping is actually bigger than the other end. But again, the research that we're doing on this stuff is only affordable because I've reached the scale where I can do this. So my time is up, and I really want to underscore what I said earlier, just in conclusion. We have the data on our side. We have an enormous opportunity as a movement here. What we need now is we need the political clout. We need to go beyond. My plea to all of us in this movement is that we don't make enemies of ourselves, that we avoid the circular firing squad stuff. We need large organic processors, and we need small local operations as well. If you prefer to buy your milk or yogurt directly from Jack at Butterworks, more power to you. I love Jack and Ann. They're some of my heroes. We stopped making unhomogenized yogurt a while ago, and you can go to my website and see. We tell people who want to buy unhomogenized yogurt to buy Butterworks. So believe me, we walk our talk. We believe in this stuff. But this business that I'm talking about here is a really big deal. Because when I look at this email that just came through today, this stupid video that's attacking good, hardworking people, and you'll see it, it's 12-minute, you know, another attack by folks, you know, progressives attacking, you know, quote unquote big organic. I want to tell you that we make enemies of ourselves. We spend money. And we as a processor and the OTA and others have to spend money to defend against this stuff. Now there's a big summit happening in Boulder in June. We're all going to try to get together and sing Kumbaya and see if we get all the different interests here. But I want to understand, let's have the debates, okay? Let's have the debates. Let's go for the science. Let's do it respectfully. Let's do it responsibly. But let's be mindful of the consequences of making the perfect the enemy of the good. Because we don't have the time to do that. And there's a lot of excellent reasons to buy local, but what was mentioned before, I can tell you, carbon footprint is not one of them. Okay? I mean, if you can buy organic and local, obviously, we should all be doing that. But transportation is a tiny fraction of the total footprint. And really, a banana, you know, we in the North, we've discovered, you know, coffee, tea, banana, vanilla, cocoa, sugar, you know, stuff that isn't grown in Vermont, although I guess climate change may solve that problem. But the reality is that, you know, when we buy that stuff, there's a toxic footprint somewhere. You know, I always tell my teenagers, when you flick a light switch on, there's a puff of smoke that goes up somewhere. But when you buy something non-organic, there's a chemical footprint somewhere. And the reality is those families I mentioned in Costa Rica would otherwise, if not for us and our buying, they would be living in, and you've seen the pictures, they'd be living with 55-gallon drums of stuff from, you know, the typical Banana Republic practices. So, in closing, to me, the challenge of creating sustainable solutions is no less than the challenge of completely regrouping our relationship to nature. Indeed, regrouping our economics. It's also about fundamentally acting responsibly. I want you to remember something that the infrastructure rebuild that we're talking about here for veterinary, for equipment, for slaughterhouses, for processing, for transportation, for seed, for refrigerated storage space, all of this stuff happens because of our numbers. And so we do need to do it all. We need to do every single thing that we can be doing. But we need to take these steps and we need to get millions of our fellow Americans and Westerners and humans to get on board. The single most powerful thing that we can be doing, along with everything else we're doing, the reason I asked the question, are you doing everything, is to get the average person to choose organic whenever they shop. That act alone, whether it's at a CSA, at a farmer's market, at a supermarket, at a restaurant, at an airport, or even a Walmart, we need to remind ourselves that a purchase is a vote. And in a capitalistic society, which we've got, and we're not going to change that in the time that we need to change this, to change the ecologic factors here. A purchase is a vote, and in this world, believe me, corporate America, policymakers, and all the others follow those votes more than they follow even electoral votes. Those dollars, when they accumulate and they turn into campaign dollars, that becomes meaningful. And the guy from Walmart said it in Food Inc. He said it was really easy for them to take a position against synthetic growth hormone. The reason was because their consumers were asking for it. It's the most powerful thing we can do. Maybe you can't afford to buy everything organic, but even an item here, an item there, is going to shift the game, and that's what we have to be talking about. You know, I'll end with my favorite quote that I often end it on because it's just so true, and this was Gandhi's. He said, anyone who thinks they're too small to make a difference has never been in bed with a mosquito. And you know, Vermont, New Hampshire, Northern New England, we know all about mosquitoes, right? That's the way we've got to be. We've got to buzz and we've got to bite. Let's not buzz and bite ourselves. Let's get out there and buzz and bite and change the way we consume and we think and create a world that our children will be proud of. Thank you so much.